planet Earth not too long ago. A rehearsal for one of Star Wars' most exciting scenes.
Bang, bang.
No, it's too late!
Bang, bang.
George Lucas, 33 years old, writer and director of Star Wars. His first feature film for Warner Brothers, THX 1138, also science fiction, but of a very different kind. His second, Universal's American Graffiti, which recalled his adolescent years in a small town in California. His third film, the phenomenally successful Star Wars, which he wrote far from Hollywood at his home in Northern California.
I think one of the key factors in the success is that it's a positive film. It has heroes and villains, and that it essentially is a fun movie to watch. It's been a long time since people have been able to go to the movies and see a sort of straightforward, wholesome, fun adventure.
In Star Wars, Lucas wanted to recapture the spirit of romance and adventure he found in the movies of the past, the kind of films that ran endlessly on television when he was growing up.
It's a good effort, Captain Tan.
My next will be better, my fancy clown.
Making his space adventure, Lucas set out to give young people another kind of fantasy world, the kind he derived from watching westerns and old Flash Gordon serial.
My forces have you surrounded, Tarkov. They will attack if you do not surrender immediately.
Well, there they are.
Have you seen you, boys?
Luke Skywalker, the young hero of Star Wars, is a direct descendant of Flash Gordon. As he evolved from script to storyboard to actor in the person of 25-year-old Mark Hamill, Luke became a projection of every young boy's adventurous spirit. For director-writer George Lucas, Luke was something of an alter ego. In the film, Luke enlists the aid of a wise and virtuous man, part warrior, part mystic, and the last survivor of a knightly order called the Jedi. His name, Obi-Wan Ben Kenobi. He is portrayed in the film by the distinguished British actor, Sir Alec Guinness. For their adventures, Luke and old Ben must ally themselves with a mercenary space pirate, the cynical Han Solo, played by Harrison Ford. For their journeys, they need Solo's space freighter, which comes with a most unusual co-pilot, Chewbacca, the Wookiee. With the two robots, this foursome will attempt to rescue a princess. As played by Carrie Fisher, this princess is royalty of a very liberated kind.
Governor Tarkin, I should have expected to find you holding Vader's leash. I recognized your foul stench when I was brought on board.
Charming to the last.
The villain and chief nemesis, Darth Vader. Even in early production sketches, Darth Vader emerged as a crown prince of evil. Sound effects editors added a final touch to his villainy. Tunisia, North Africa. Here, George Lucas and a film crew of 130 people from England and the United States recreated the planet of Tatooine. A strange world where the robots landed after their escape from the Imperial forces. To create the world of Tatooine, cargo planes and oversized trans-European moving vans brought thousands of pieces of equipment and props to the remote Tunisian desert. Construction crews worked for 2 months to build the dwellings and towns of the exotic planet. Among the strangest inhabitants of Tatooine, robots, or droids as they are called in the film. 25 different models of them. It is on Tatooine that the robots C-3PO and R2-D2 will encounter the young farm boy, Luke Skywalker. It is also on Tatooine that they will be confronted by the Jawas, bright-eyed wanderers of the wasteland. Animal, vegetable, or mineral, the early production drawings of the Sand People don't specify. George Lucas imagined them as ferocious nomads, and ferocious is what they turned out to be, as demonstrated in this scene photographed on location. Sir Alec Guinness, a knight playing a knight, brought to the Star Wars set a theatrical tradition that inspired the youthful production company. In this, his first appearance as Obi-Wan Ben Kenobi, he rescues Luke Skywalker from the Sand People. It is now that R2-D2 discovers that Obi-Wan is the man to whom he must deliver the secret message. The message cannot be delivered, however, until a damaged friend has been repaired. Through the magic of film, Luke's land speeder hovers over the desert sands. But for scenes requiring starts and stops, part of the magic becomes transparent. In this scene, Luke discovers his family has been killed by the Imperial forces. He now makes a fateful decision.
There's nothing for me here now. I want to learn the ways of the Force and become a Jedi like my father.
Han Solo's space freighter, the Millennium Falcon, was Star Wars' most elaborate set. It was constructed on one of the 9 sound stages the company used at the Elstree Studios outside London.
It's better on this side of it than this side.
It's better with this there on your right because I don't see it.
Nailed to the floor of the sound stage, the mock-up of the Falcon remains strangely earthbound. Later on the screen, it will appear to hurtle through the vastness of space.
Running.
Action!
Can't you outrun him? I thought you said this thing was fast.
Watch your mouth, kid. You're gonna find yourself floating.
For all of its sophistication as a set, the motion of the Falcon is generated by a few stagehands.
Okay, cut. 559, take two. Action.
Can't you outrun him? I thought you said the thing was fast.
Harrison Ford, who pilots the Falcon, worked with Lucas in American Graffiti. He played a similar role of a man obsessed by speed and ego.
Here's where the fun begins.
I ain't nobody, dork. Right?
Right.
Hey, you see this Milner, you tell him I'm looking for him, huh?
Ain't he neat?
In fact, a lot of the elements of Han Solo are a lot like Bob Falfa in American Graffiti. But I don't, I hope they're not the same person. I never intended them to be. The jump to hyperspace is like, it's like the drag racing in American Graffiti. Chewbacca. Chewbacca is the Wookiee. He's 200 years old. And I don't know if this ever comes out in the picture, but he is 200 years old. He's capable of flying the spaceship. And I'm capable of understanding his language. I relate it to him as if he were a special kind of dog. I thought kids would find him real frightening. So I wanted a relationship with him that would imply trust and equality.
The Wookiee actually came from my dog, Indiana, who is a big Malamute, very large, furry dog. It looks a lot like the Wookiee, only slightly smaller.
The chess pieces are actually rubber figures wired with movable joints. Using stop-action photography, every movement of the creatures is filmed one frame at a time. When played back, the creatures come to life in continuous motion. They are then added to the chessboard. There are 365 special photographic effects in Star Wars, more than in any other movie. For this scene, each effect element was shot separately, then added to the live action. Even the laser beam of Luke's sword was optically printed into the scene. Other elements like the chess set and rays were added in the same way.
Remember, a Jedi can feel the Force flowing through him.
You mean it controls your actions?
Partially, but it also obeys your commands.
The Force, which Obi-Wan attempts to pass on to Luke, is a vital element in Star Wars.
It's sort of boiling down religion into a very basic concept. The fact that there is some deity or some power or some force that sort of controls our destiny, works for good and also works for evil, is always been very basic in mankind.
The dark side of the Force is personified by Darth Vader.
It is insignificant next to the power of the Force.
Don't try to frighten us with your sorcerer's ways, Lord Vader. Your sad devotion to that ancient religion has not helped you conjure up the stolen data tapes or given you clairvoyance enough to find the rebels' hidden fort.
I find your lack of faith disturbing.
Enough of this. Vader, release him.
As you wish.
The Falcon, in which the intrepid adventurers are traveling, is in fact a model. Designed and built by a Hollywood special effects house, it is photographed by a computer-controlled camera. By photographing the model against a blue screen, it will later be possible to add different backgrounds and other moving objects to the scene. This can be done by means of double and triple exposures. The work is painstaking and precise. It is an endeavor where details count. Scenes filmed on the London sound stages will also be integrated with the model shots made in California. To achieve this, the actors must also be filmed against a blue screen.
Tell anybody about us.
In the Falcon cockpit, the actors play out their terror at being caught in a magnetic pull exerted by a yet unpictured Death Star.
It's too big for a space station.
I have a very bad feeling about this.
Turn the ship around.
Yeah, I think you're right. Full reverse, Chewie!
In order to complete the scene, it is necessary to generate what the special effects people call mats.
It's pulling us in.
They permit the separate elements to be printed one at a time. In this case, the actors, the graphic of the Death Star, and a star field. When finally combined, the star field, the Death Star graphic, the model, and the actors filmed on stage contribute to the creation of a dramatic sequence. Another technological achievement was the creation of 33 fully operative robots. R2-D2 was the crowning achievement of these mechanical creatures. An achievement of another kind was the creation of the more human-like droid C-3PO. He and his companion became both dream and nightmare to their creator, George Lucas.
I started writing this. I found the most intriguing thing was to take two robots and make them into human beings and make them the most interesting characters in terms of the comedy element and the sort of, I wanted to make the film around them, use them as a framework for the film. And I knew when I did that, that I would be getting myself into a lot of trouble.
Difficulties with the robots led to a loss of time. And in the Star Wars location, where each day could cost upwards of $100,000, the director's affection for his creations had to be tempered with impatience. Carrie Fisher is Princess Leia. Born to show business, she is the daughter of Debbie Reynolds and Eddie Fisher.
Playing the role of Princess Leia was fun a lot of times. Well, it wasn't fun all the time. After about 2 hours in the garbage room, the fun started to wear off and your skin started to wrinkle and your rubber suit didn't fit right anymore. But we had a good time. When we did the swing across, it would have been fun if we'd been allowed to do it a second time. But it was like doing the upside down roller coaster. We did it one time and it was scary. And then if we'd gotten to do it again, it would have been fun. But they didn't let us do it again.
Here, hold this.
A daring swing was frightening because it actually took place 30 feet above the floor of the studio. But not all of Star Wars' towering scenes were filmed at dizzying heights. Here, Obi-Wan attempts to turn off the magnetic beam which prevents the Falcon from escaping the Death Star. He is only 6 feet off the stage floor. In the final film, he will appear to be 100 feet off the floor.
A very good clues.
Alec Guinness talks about playing his role in this kind of special effects film.
Borrow a little bit here and there. But it's no good trying to think of this character in terms of a psychologically rational man. There's a bit of magic about it. And I just trust that the camera and the backgrounds will provide the rest.
To match the director's concept for this scene, without actually building a huge and expensive set, the filmmakers resort to what is called a glass painting shot. Thousands of miles from the stage in England, a California artist paints a background on glass that will later surround the scene in which Alec Guinness appears. A blank spot is left on the glass painting for the live-action scene filmed on the London stage. The glass painting is then photographed, and the scene with Alec Guinness will be incorporated within it. The final effect is a masterful illusion.
Making Star Wars was a lot like the movie. You never knew what was going to happen next.
For 10 long weeks, the Star Wars company labored on the suburban London sound stages, bringing to life a film that had begun as an idea with George Lucas 3 years before. For Lucas, these 10 weeks were pressure-laden as he struggled to keep the 130-member company on schedule. For the actors, it is both a time of excitement and tedium. To outsiders, the filmmaking world looks to be a fun-filled, glamorous environment. It is actually a workaday world of detail and repetition. The cast of Star Wars makes an 18th attempt to escape from the Death Star.
Okay, cut.
Cut it.
The mic was in frame.
The mic was in picture.
The mic was in picture. Come on back to first position.
The sound department at the FAM. It was good for me.
Okay, print it and burn it.
The stormtroopers who police the Death Star must also be filmed for the climactic escape sequence. Here they prepare to witness the fateful duel between Obi-Wan and Darth Vader.
Waiting for you, Obi-Wan. We meet again at last. The circle is now complete. When I left you, I was but the learner. Now I am the master.
Only a master of evil, Darth.
Again, special effects were used to heighten the action in the scene. Alec Guinness enters carrying only the hilt of his sword. He is given a second sword made of special light-reflecting material. When this sword is turned to the light, the reflection will appear to be the laser beam. However, for a more dramatic effect, an animated glow is added to the laser sword. Flashes of color are also printed in to enhance the scene. Sound effects add another dimension to the drama. Another angle of this climactic moment is photographed. This one without Alec Guinness. A dummy is substituted. For this scene, Lucas and his technicians are trying to achieve a difficult mechanical effect on the set.
Severed. But it all came down together.
The scene is not working. Lucas will later make the decision to enhance this scene with an optical effect. Here on what was the largest soundstage in England, the Star Wars company prepares to shoot the climax of R2's incredible adventure, one he embarks upon with Luke Skywalker. Rebel forces are about to launch an aerial attack against the Death Star. The secret message that R2 has brought back is used to help plan the raid.
Mr. Bourne, he's a great pilot.
Thank you, sir. I'll try.
I gotta get aboard.
We'll hear all your stories when we get back, all right?
Hey, Big. The adventure sought by Luke Skywalker, the farm boy from Tatooine, is about to reach its most dangerous moment. For the first time since leaving home, he is on his own.
The character of Luke Skywalker is the one sounding board you have. And like Dorothy in Wizard of Oz or Jack Hawkins in Treasure Island, there's that one character that people look to see the reactions to everything else. He's very simple, very naive, very straightforward. He's that classic character in literature that doesn't want to stay on the farm, that wants to see what's beyond, and, you know, get off the farm and go have a little adventure.
The adventure into which Luke Skywalker is thrust is derived from World War II dogfights as shown in Hollywood films. For the space-age dogfight, detailed models are used. With the computer controls developed especially for Star Wars, it was possible to film the elements for this sequence with a freedom never before exercised in motion picture production. By controlling the motion of the camera and by remembering those motions, the computer allows for more complex and visually dynamic photography. Again, the models are photographed against blue screen to allow for the placement of other elements into the scene. The surface of the Death Star, until now seen only as a graphic, must now be rendered as a model. To effect attacks on the model by the rebel planes, explosions are sometimes triggered by primitive mechanisms. Similarly, the miniature planes are wired with small charges. It took 2 years and $3.5 million to do the Star Wars miniature and optical defects. This camera provides a pilot's eye view of an attack on the Death Star. Thousands of hours are devoted to collecting all the elements necessary for the final sequence. With the success of the film, the country goes Star Wars crazy. In the modern world, success can't be confined to one medium. It spills over into every area of our lives. Star Wars has spawned more Star Wares than anyone can count. It has become an inescapable phenomenon. The music of Star Wars by John Williams is part of that phenomenon. And what about sequels? The producer of Star Wars, Gary Kurtz.
We had a lot of speculation about sequels to Star Wars, and we are working on story material that will develop into potentially one or more motion pictures that will use the same characters. I like to consider them different adventures rather than direct sequels.
Obviously, the Empire is still there. Darth Vader is still there, and it's going to also evolve with new characters coming in, new problems, new worlds.
It's still being written, the sequel, and we're all signed for them to do them, Mark Harrison and I, and the robots, 3PO and R2. But that's as far as I know. I heard that they were probably going to have an ice planet and a tropical planet, like the fourth moon of Yavin.
But then again, George can do anything he wants now. The first one has been so successful that he could set the next one in Redondo Beach if he chooses to do so.
There are questions that still need to be answered. Like, what about the future of the princess?
And who she is going to end up with is still anybody's guess. I will say that Luke is more devoted to her, I think, than Han Solo is.
I would probably describe Han Solo as the cynical mercenary space pirate with the cream filling, you know. He's a nice guy.
She's really a chump if she goes for Han Solo.
And what of Darth Vader? Will he get his comeuppance?
I don't like Darth, and I don't mind talking about it either. I think he's a bad guy, and I'm going to probably do my best to shoot him next time. I think he's powerful and dangerous.
They put us on a gigantic playground and gave us mounds of toys to play with. It was like playing cowboys and Indians for money.
It was a lot of fun. How much fun? About this much.
The magic of Star Wars does not lie only in its brilliant special effects. Its power derives from something simpler and rarer, the romantic spirit that moves in it. Before it, we are all young again, and everything seems possible.